tonight with you. Have you ever wonder if, and I see some new faces, so thank you guys so much for coming. And old faces too, not like old, but people who've been here a lot of time. Yeah, not like we're old, but or me. But anyways, it's have you ever wondered if you have a purpose? Now, we all probably have wondered that at times in our life. We probably wondered if not, at least we've wondered where our purpose is, right? We try to discover what, you know, what is it God has planned? Is there something that God has planned for me? Is there anything that He has specifically planned for me that it makes it unique? I think at times we all go through that. We all kind of struggle. And maybe when I was a college age student, right about where most of you are, I really struggled with that. I struggled with both my purpose in life. I didn't know. I felt God calling me to something, but I didn't know really what that was. And I wanted to do one thing. You know, I wanted to you know, play baseball, but I got to do that a little bit, but I knew that wasn't going to be my future. And then so I thought, well, I don't know what to do. You know, I remember, I've told you this before, but I was 23 years old. Our last baseball game, we had just finished, we lost in the World Series. We were in Des Moines, Iowa, which if you get a chance to go to Des Moines, Iowa, let me just save you the trouble, don't go. There's not much there, at least there wasn't 30 years ago, but anyways, so 26 years ago, something like that. We were standing in right field. We just lost in the World Series, and we were standing in right field, and I was 23 years old, and I'm thinking, I don't know what to do. I mean, I was crying because, you know, we lost. I was also crying because I had no idea what I was supposed to do now. My whole life revolved around one thing, and that one thing wasn't a bad thing necessarily. It just, that was my whole life. And now I knew that part of my life was over. What do I do now? You know, there's going to be a new normal, and I don't know what that is. I knew God had called me to something, but I didn't want to accept that. I wasn't pursuing God in that way, even though I knew He had called me. So what do we do when we don't know what to do? When what we thought was our goal in life, or our dream, our purpose, whatever. What do we do when that's kind of taken from us, or we're on a new path that's kind of uncharted territory? And I've told you before, I don't like uncharted territory. I really like knowing where I'm going, and I really like the fact that I've been there before, right? So I have some frame of reference. I don't like new things necessarily. That's not really my sweet spot. So but when we get into this time in our life, there's a lot of newness, isn't there? You guys are entering a stage of life, no matter if you're 20 or 25 or 27 or 20, it doesn't matter. You're entering into a stage of life where it's just, there's a lot of newness happening right now. Some of you become parents for the very first time. That's a brand new thing, and that's a scary thing. It's an awesome thing, but it's a scary thing. I remember when Stephen was born, 24 years ago almost. I was scared to death. I don't know what to do. I'd never been a dad before. There were no classes, right? I mean, I guess we had some classes, but I didn't really pay attention to mom classes or whatever. But I was just, you know, the breeding coach, which is, you know, a glorified title for standing there scared to death, right? I didn't know what I was doing. But anyways, so you're moving into uncharted territory. And I guess, in a sense, we all are at stages in life. I think especially for your age, you really are. You're either entering college, or you're about to enter out of college, or you're entering the workforce, or there's just a lot of newness happening. So, what does that have to do with your purpose? Does God use that, and does He have a purpose for you? Is there a purpose for you in your life? When I was younger, none of you in the room, with the exception of maybe two or three people, and I won't name who you are, but when you remember this show, when I was a kid, there was a game show back when they used to have game shows on, like, regular TV, not like the game show channel or whatever, but it was regular TV, and in the evenings there'd be game shows on, and there was one called Liar's Club. And I don't remember a whole lot about the show, it didn't last very long, I don't think, but there would be like three celebrities, and they had this object, like they were given an object like this. And it's something cooler than this, but I forgot to bring an object, so I didn't have something here. But anyways, they were always given some object, and nobody knew what it was. And so there was two contestants sitting next to the game show host, you know, there's always a game show host. And the three celebrities would tell a story or explain what that object was. And so the contestants, if it was their turn, they had to choose which one. There was one person telling the truth, and there were two people that were lying. Or maybe one person lying and two people. Or yeah, one person telling the truth, the other two were lying. So they had to choose, the contestants had to choose which one was telling the truth. It was called Liar's Club. And they would have just obscure things. Now, we all know, if you see this, you would know that this is a pulley type of thing. You twist and it tightens up. Then I found this thing over here, and I have no idea what this is. It says push right here, so you put, it's a spout for something, but they would make up this elaborate story for something like this, and the contestants would have to decide, yeah, I think you're telling the truth, or you're lying, right? But the point is, they would use these objects that looked, I mean, they just were silly-looking objects, and they would make up crazy stories, and the point is, even every object they used had a purpose. Now, they had to decide which one was telling the truth about the purpose, but every object had a purpose. And I want you to see over the next few weeks, whether you realize it or not, you probably do, but whether you realize it or not, over the next few weeks, we're going to look at the fact that you, in fact, do have a purpose. God created you with a specific plan and a purpose in mind. You may not know exactly what that is yet, and that's okay. Some of us, it takes a while for us to discover our purpose. And I would tell you this, that your purpose may adapt a little bit over time. It may change a little bit over time. I haven't always done young adult ministry. I used to do student ministry. So that was my goal. That was what I was supposed to do. Well, then God kind of changed my, you know, transitioned me out of that role and into a different role. So, and I'm a whole lot older than any of you. So, it may change or morph a little bit or adapt over time. The point is, God does have a purpose for you. And no matter what we go through, even though it feels like sometimes the rug has been swept out from underneath us, that purpose is still alive and well. And if God's will, if He has a purpose for you, then nothing that happens in the world will take that purpose away. Nothing will take that, what God's plan and desire for you, nothing will take it away. So, we're looking at what is your spiritual destiny, or discovering your destiny. Here's what I mean by destiny. This is not, let me just say, this is not some self-help or, you know, you do these seven things and you'll be happy and wealthy and wise, and it's none of that. This is not your best life now. This is none of that. This is from Scripture that God has a plan for your destiny. It's your spiritual destiny. He has a plan for it. Destiny, here's what I wrote down for destiny. It means something that is to happen or has happened to a person or thing. That's your destiny. It's something that has happened or will happen to you or to something else. We all have a destiny. We all have something that's going to happen to us. Some of you are brand new to this adulting, right? And it's not easy, right? It's not. I remember first becoming an adult, and I'm thinking, I don't like this very much. I don't like adulting. I didn't like being at home, necessarily. I wanted to get out of my dad's house because my dad was great, is a great guy and loves me dearly, and I think he still does, but he did then, and so, but he was just strict, you know. I wanted out of the house, and then I got to become an adult. I'm like, I don't really want to do this anymore. I want to go back, right? I want to want to, you know, where other people provide for me, well, I provide for myself. So adulting can become somewhat difficult. But listen, there are some sites that will, some websites that will, I found one that, I won't tell you the name of the site, but anyways, I found, I just did a Google search on, you know, destiny or purpose, you know, the sites that will help you find your purpose. There's one site, and listen, every source out there will promise you answers to anything you're looking for. You'll find a source out there that will promise you some sort of answer to whatever you're looking for, okay? There's one site that said it promises to help you to discover your destiny in 20 minutes or less. 20 minutes or less. It promises to help you discover your destiny. Can I just say that you're not going to discover your destiny tonight in 20 minutes or less, okay? Not because I'm going to preach longer than that. I'm just saying that I can't tell you what that is. Now, I can tell you what part of it is, because I think part of our destiny is we kind of share. It's universal. That's a personal opinion of mine, that I think that God desires all of us to have a relationship with. That's part of our spiritual destiny. Now, what we do with that and how we make him known to other people, that's where it gets a little different. That's where it changes some, because how you do it is going to be different than how I do it. How I do it may be different than how you do what God has called you to do. But God does, I believe, call all of us, desire for all of us to have a relationship with him. Not that everyone will, but that everyone would have. He made a way through his son Jesus so that we would all know him, or could all know him in a personal way. Now, how we then make him known to other people, that's where it gets a little different. So we're not going to discover your spiritual destiny in life in 20 minutes. We're not even going to discover it probably in 5 or 6 weeks. But we're going to chart out a little map here that hopefully will help show you from Scripture what it talks about and how God's destiny for you is unique just for you. And you do have a purpose. You do have a destiny. So tonight, we're going to start off with Ephesians chapter 2. We're not going to go through a certain book of the Bible, but Ephesians chapter 2 gives us a great place to start. So Paul's writing in verses 8 through 10, he says this: "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not on your own doing, but as a gift of God." So in other words, we don't save ourselves. It's a gift from God. It's God's gift to us that we have salvation. And then he says, verse 9, we have this gift because not as a result of works, that's the good deeds that we do, so that anyone can boast. If I can earn it, if I can earn God's love or salvation, then I can brag about that. It's about me. Look at me. So he's saying we can't do that, so none of us would boast. Then verse 10 is where it gets really, really cool. "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Let me pray for you again one more time. Father, thank you for your word. Lord, I pray that you would open our eyes and open our hearts tonight. I pray that you would remove all distractions, especially from my mind that's going on right now. Remove all distractions, that we would just focus on you for the next few moments together tonight, that we would begin to discover and discern what your destiny or what your purpose for our lives is. Speak to us now, God. Any servants are listening. We long to hear from you. God, I ask these things in your name. Amen. So, first thing we notice is that, number one, when to discover your spiritual destiny, we got to understand that you and I, we are a work of art. Now, notice I didn't say you're a piece of work. Everybody been taught that before? Anybody been taught, you're just a piece of work. Yeah. No, we're not. You're not a piece. You're a work of art. That's what he says in verse 8. He says, your workmanship, that which has been made, that comes from, and I don't know a lot of Greek or Hebrew, I don't want to bore you with much of that, but the Greek word for that is poema, and we get the word poem from that, and it means that the beautiful piece of work. When God created you, he knew what he was doing. I struggled with that for so long because I never felt like I was talented enough or whatever. I never was enough of what I wanted to be. I wanted to be like other people. I wanted to be, you know, I wanted to be able to do things like my older brother, or I wanted to do stuff. I just, whatever it was, it just was never enough in my mind. But according to this, God created me just like He created you. Now, I think we are to grow and mature, okay, in our faith. We're not to just sit back and settle. I don't think you'll ever see anywhere in Scripture where it calls us to settle. Settle for less. We don't settle for less. We're to be all that God saved us to be. Live an abundant life. John 10:10 tells us that it says the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus came that you would have life and have an abundant life. Here and now. That's not just eternal life. It's abundant life here and now. Listen, if you're going to live an abundant life, if God, Jesus calls us to live an abundant life, there's no settling. So I'm not asking, I'm not telling you that the Scripture tells you to settle. But we have to be content with who we are, with who God created us, and then be all that we can be for Him. And I'm not trying to steal that from the Army or whoever that is that uses that. I think it's the Army, be all you can be. Do they still use that? You're looking at me like, no, they don't use that anymore. Okay, so I'm so traumatic. So anyways, you're priceless. To God, you are a priceless work of art. Do you have anything, do your parents have anything that just to them is priceless? I mean, it may not be worth a whole lot in worldly terms. I have a Bible on my desk at church that belonged to my mom. Lorraine and I bought it for probably 2 or 3 years before she passed away. And when she passed away in 1998, when none of you in the room were alive, pretty much. But when she passed away, the only thing really that I wanted, and my mom didn't have a lot of, you know, she didn't have a lot of stuff. Well, she had a lot of stuff, but she didn't have a lot of, like, material things. It was just wasn't really her. The only thing I wanted was that Bible. And let me tell you something. I wouldn't take anything for it. Not because I bought it for her necessarily, or we bought it for her. It was hers. And so it's on my desk, and when I look at it, I see where she wrote notes, where she underlined certain things. She wrote in her Bible quite a bit, and it's very worn. Even though she only had it for a couple years, it's very worn. And it's not worn because I'm using it a lot. It's very worn because she just used it a lot. And priceless. It probably isn't worth much in worldly standards, but to me, I wouldn't pay anything for it. Because it's priceless. We see ourselves and we think, well, we're not worth much in worldly standards. Maybe we're not as talented as we'd like to be, or whatever. But to God, we are priceless. You are priceless. He said, imagine this. He sent His only Son to die for you and for me. I've got 2 sons. I can imagine that. I can imagine doing the sacrificing that. In Isaiah chapter 29, it says that we are His children. We are His work, the work of His hands. And then Isaiah 43, verse 7 says, everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory. This is God speaking. Whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. He made you. He created you. Yes, to be the best you that you can be. He created you. And that's enough. That should be enough. We don't have to wish we were somebody else or had other gifts and talents. We just need to be all that God has saved us to be, all He's created us to be. And that should be enough because we are His work of art. We are a piece of work, but we are a priceless gift to God. Psalm 139, verse 14 says this, I praise you, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works. My soul knows it very well. I praise you, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. You and I, we are fearfully and wonderfully made.
wonderfully made by the hand of God. And if that doesn't cause us to just be in awe of Him, I don't know what else would. Now listen, I know things don't always go the way we want them to go in life. I get that. And we have setbacks. And we have to do like a plan B maybe. I don't know. Our original plan didn't really work out the way we wanted it to. I get that. And we have to readjust some things. But listen, just because it may be a surprise to you, it doesn't mean it's a surprise to God. Because God had a plan from the very beginning. And we'll look at that in just a second. Next time you hear a lie from the enemy telling you you're not this enough, you're not that enough, remember, it's from the enemy. It's not from God. Next time you hear that lie from the enemy, just replace it with the truth of God's word. It says, I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. And He has a plan for you. And He has a plan for me. It doesn't mean that we're not going to continue to grow. We have to continue to grow. But listen, we need to see ourselves as a gift from God. Anything less than that is we are weakening the truth of God and His word and His power. Okay? Secondly, when we realize to discover our destiny, secondly, we need to know that we are created with a purpose. He says in verse 8 and 9, you are created. Now there's a lot of works so that no one would boast, but he says you're created for good works. You're not saved by your works. We don't earn a relationship with Christ by the good things that we do. The good things that we do reveal that we do have a relationship with Christ. We are saved by faith. That's what he says. He says in the very first thing, he says, for by grace you have been saved through faith. Through your faith in Him, by God's grace, and through our faith in Him, He saves us. What happens when He saves us? Then we do good works. We do good deeds for other people. The purpose, if you're a Christ follower, is to do good works. Your works reveal who you belong to. James tells us in chapter 2, verses 17 and 18. He says, so also faith by itself does not have works is dead. But someone will say, you have faith, I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. We show our faith and our relationship in lots of ways, but primarily through our works, through our things that we do for other people. Even when we don't always want to do those things, we do those things because God has called us to. And that shows, that reveals our relationship with Him. And what are good works? It's just doing those things. It's evidence that we belong to Him. Listen to me. Is there evidence in your life that you have a relationship with Christ, that you belong to Him? I'm not asking you if you've ever messed up and you never miss opportunities. Listen, we all mess up. We all miss opportunities. We miss opportunities. I miss opportunities every single day to be a witness for God, to do good things for other people because of my faith. And sometimes I catch it. Sometimes I don't. Sometimes I catch it and I think, oh man, I missed an opportunity. I missed an opportunity. Last week, I had to preach on Wednesday night for our pastor. He was out of town, and somebody that I didn't know wanted to meet with me in my office at like 5 o'clock, and our service is at 6:15. And I'll be honest with you, I was like, man, I don't really have time. I don't really want to do that because I want to prepare for the message tonight and all that. So I didn't want to. My heart wasn't in it. I'll be honest, my heart wasn't in it. But I told the person, I said, yeah, come on, come on and meet. And it was, listen, if I would not have met with this person, it was a God thing that I met with this person. It was unbelievable. This person had been far from God for a long time. And now, I mean, just it was an amazing conversation. And I would have missed out on a blessing. Not that I was a blessing to her. She was really a blessing to me. And she didn't even know it.
Right.
She had no idea. She wasn't coming for that. She was coming for some counsel. She was a blessing to me. And I would have missed it if I would have given in to my, I don't have time for this, and just let it go. listen, we show our faith by our good works. This Saturday, we'll give you some more details later, but this coming Saturday, there's a ministry in Spring Hill called The Well, oddly enough. We didn't steal it from them. I promise, just like I promised the people at The Well in Spring Hill, we didn't steal the name from you. I didn't even know, you know, anything. But anyways, they do a mobile food bank, and they minister to people in different ways. So we're going to partner with them this Saturday. If you're available, if you could just, we'll give you some things to do in a minute. But on your card, you know, Kayla talked about your prayer cards. If you would like to write on that, or maybe a white card, just say, yeah, I'd love to help serve. We're going to serve from 8 to 12. It's in Spring Hill, and we'll, if you fill out and put it in a prayer card, we'll get in touch with you and tell you where to go, what to do. We'll maybe go do lunch together afterwards. But it's a mobile food bank, and we're just going to go serve. I don't know what all they need us to do. I have no idea. Caleb and I met the lady who's in charge of it. We were standing in line having coffee, getting ready to have coffee at Fanny Goat several months ago. And she saw Caleb's hat, and she said, do you lead worship? And he's like, yeah, I lead this thing called The Well, or he leads the church, but I lead this thing called The Well. She said, oh, I'm The Well, or whatever, you know. So it was kind of, I don't really remember, because I kind of got late to the conversation. But so we sat down and talked to her for a few minutes, and just a sweet lady, and great ministry. So I thought, hey, what a great opportunity for The Well to serve at The Well Spring Hill. So we're going to go this Saturday from 8 to 12. We can only take about 10 people because it's kind of a small space. But if you're willing to go, if you want to go, if you want to put your faith out there and your works into action, just sign up. Put your name on a card, put it in the prayer box, and we'll call you. We'll contact you with all the details. Just right in Spring Hill. But anyways, that's good work, showing others that Christ loves them and he died for them. Just like he died for you and me, he died for them as well. Jesus says in Matthew, here's what he says in chapter 5. This is part of the Sermon on the Mount, verse 13. You're the salt of the earth, but the salt has lost its taste. How shall the saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. I love that phrase. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket. Why? Who would do that, right? We put it on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and not glorify you and not praise you. They would see your good works and glory and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Listen, I love that. Where it says a city on a hill cannot be hidden. If I genuinely have a relationship with Christ, according to Jesus himself, and I'd say he's pretty much the authority on this, according to Jesus, it's impossible to have a relationship and it not be seen by others. Not in some way. There has to be some tangible way where that relationship is seen by other people, not so that we would be noticed, not so that we would get any recognition, but so that God would get glory. He says, there's no way, it's impossible. The purpose of our new creation is to do good works that we were created to do. The last thing, number 3, to discover your destiny, you have to realize that you were created not just with a purpose, but you were created with a plan. Did you catch in the last verse, verse 10, in Ephesians, he says, for we are his workmanship, created in Jesus Christ, Christ Jesus, for good works, which God prepared beforehand. That's a key verse. That's a key phrase. He prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. So here's what this means to me. God prepared before time began, before you and I even existed. He is sovereign. We serve a sovereign God. And he knew exactly that you would be here tonight. I think. He knew exactly what we would be doing. He knew exactly what's going on. Before the beginning of time, he knew exactly. exactly what was going to happen. God prepared beforehand that this is how we should walk. He had a plan. And he still has a plan for you. And listen, it may not look right now like you want it to look. I get that. Sometimes it takes some time, right? Are you a planner? Do you like to have a plan?
I don't really want to know, like, I don't know all the details. I'm not a detailed person. I'm really not. Like, for example, you know, if I ask you what time it is, don't tell me how they built your watch and all that. I don't care. I just want to know what time it is, right? So I don't really want to know all of the ins and outs of everything, but I do like to have a plan. I'm a planner. I like to have a plan in place. I like to know my destination. I don't read instructions very well. When I'm putting things together, I'll read a couple of things, and then I just throw those things away, and then I just go for it, right? But I do like to have, which usually doesn't work out too well for me, but I do like to have a plan. Whether or not it's instructions or not, I do like to have a plan. But I hate not having one. And so I want other people, right? Like, in other words, if you ever go through a drive-through restaurant, fast food restaurant with me in the drive-through, please know what you're going to order. For the love of God, right now, please know what you're going to order. You can ask my wife. I get so aggravated when we pull up to, I don't know if we have any different drive-through lately, but anyways, if we pull up to Taco Bell and nobody knows what they want, I'm like, seriously, it's Taco. I mean, you know, it's not like Sonic where you can just go and wait and push the button when you're ready, right? You have to, when you pull into a drive-thru, you've got to know, and that infuriates me when we don't have a plan. We don't know. All four of us in the car, when the kids are younger, and nobody knows what they want, and I'm just like, I'd rather be anywhere else but here right now. Nobody knows what they want, and the person on the other line, they're waiting. So have a plan. Please have a plan when you go to a drive-thru restaurant, especially if I'm in the car, okay? Listen, God had a plan when he created you. And while his plan may have looked like it's taken some detours in your life, I get that. It's still his plan for you. Don't ever doubt that. Yes, we're to grow. Yes, we're to mature in our faith. Yes, we're going to do different things. I used to pour concrete for a living, for crying out loud. And then I taught elementary PE. You believe that? I did that for like 5 years. And the whole time I'm thinking, truly, this is not God's plan for me. These kids are wearing me out, right? I got tired of tying shoes every single day. And then I have kids come up to me in kindergarten. They come up to me and say, Coach Henry, they call me Coach Henry or Mr. Henry, whatever. And they say, Coach Henry, my mom said not to let you tie my shoes anymore because they couldn't get them untied when I said I'd tell the mom. The mom couldn't get it untied. So anyway, I got tired of doing that. And I thought, surely this is not God's plan, ultimate plan for me. And it wasn't, but it was for that season. It was for that season in my life. So maybe God takes you through some seasons in your life that leads you to his ultimate plan for you and his purpose for you. Don't ever believe the lie that you're wasting time if you're seeking God. If you're seeking God, he has a plan for you, and you are doing exactly what he wants you to be doing, even though it may not feel like it. I get it. I've been there, and I'm there at times still, but he has a plan for those of us that walk with him. Jeremiah 29:11, which is used out of context so often, it just really, really is. But listen, right here, I think it really speaks truth. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Now, this was written under a lot of different contexts, okay? At the time when it was written in Jeremiah. But the truth of the matter is God has a plan for you. And it's not for our demise. It's not for our... It's not for us to struggle even though sometimes, you know, being suffering for the cause is what we're called to do. But God has a plan for you, and in the end, it may look like we're suffering, it may look like we're struggling. In the end, it's ultimately for His good, and for our good, and for His glory. His plan is just for you. His plans are good. They're not always easy. Sometimes they're difficult, right? It's difficult sometimes, but they're always good. Not always easy, but they're always good. And there's a reason for that. Because it's divine destiny. And He's molding you and I to be the person that He wants us to be. And listen, sometimes that molding process is painful. Sometimes it's difficult. Sometimes I don't like it. Because it's changing what I'm used to. I told you, you know, last week we were some of us in the room were in Wales. And Wales is not it's not a third world country, it's pretty modern. But still there's some things different over there. Like most things are a lot smaller over there. I don't know what that is, but like sinks are not even like this big. I mean, it's tiny. Bathrooms are smaller. I don't want to stand on bathrooms here, but anyways, everything's smaller. It seems like cars are smaller. And the bed that I slept in is a lot smaller. You know, things are smaller. They're just different. Not bad. It's just different. But I was uncomfortable for some of the time I was there because I wasn't used to it. It's just different. But it doesn't mean it's bad. Just because God may have you in a different place right now, doesn't mean it's bad. He is trying to mold you and me to be the people, the person that He desires us to be. Rest in God for a while. Don't try to force the issue. Just stay there. Rest in Him. You have a divine destiny, and only that is unique to you.